in the sky are like the European integration, the EEA agreement, the fundamental rights, the responsibility of all actors involved, and that means European Union, European institutions, European Union member states, private, public actors. Then the model, we should not forget the model of capitalism based on a neoliberal approach, yes, which has freed it from social responsibilities. And also I would like to connect it last but not least with something that I think it is going on in the world, which is a movement for global justice activism. Uh-huh. And there we have people like that have been always in that have been also invited to the program, like Nobel Prize or to Iceland at least, the Nobel Prize economist Joseph Stiglitz, Amartya Sen, or even global activists like Naomi Klein. She has written a book that I strongly recommend for Icelanders called The Shock Doctrine, yes, yes, where she revises the history of the economic world in the last 30 years. And the role of the International Monetary Fund, unfortunately, is not very good. So I encourage people to go through these things. My main conclusion, I would say, is double.
Yeah.
Is that there has been an oversimplification of the analysis, of all the analysis that has been done, and the solution that has been adopted in the ISAFE dispute, because the responsibility lies at all levels, national, European, public, private, etc. And just to decide that Iceland has 100% of responsibility and liability is too simplistic for me. It's like this. It's like this ulendulendorf that we have in Iceland, you know.
Yeah,
The issues are not so simple. They're much complicated. So oversimplification of the analysis, oversimplification of the solution, and of course the methodology has not been appropriate. Yeah. And then another thing that is the positive thing is that the protests from Iceland and now the presidential decision to leave, to let the final word for Icelandic citizens, is a request, in my view, for the European institutions, for Europe and the world, to think about the European integrations in terms of social justice and fundamental rights.
Not just business models, yeah, financial models.
Yeah, not just so that the European integration and the European institutions do not build a Europe for creditors, for multinationals, but just for us, little people, ordinary citizens of Europe. And I think that is a very strong message that the European Union should listen to, because I think that when 317,000 Icelanders have become experts in the internal market, in financial services, we could all attend meetings in Brussels to discuss this. We could all participate in the reconstruction of a model. Yeah. And with a big group of people, such a big as that, follows 60,000 voters that want to have the final decision, it's a strong message for democracy in Europe.
But the problem is that the crisis could have been, or it should have been, maybe an opportunity to restructure a lot of things, readjust a lot of things, but it seems that we are missing out on that.
Yeah.
Jacques Delors has mentioned this in an article you have cited.
Yeah, there is several figures in Europe that have been very critical. Jacques Delors is one of them. Also Felipe González, and maybe Madame Joly was referring to him. Even I would like to remember, for instance, that even the president of the European Commission now, Joao Manuel Barroso from Portugal, he had a very hard time before the European Parliament in September being re-elected, because the European Parliament told him, you have built a Europe for multinationals and you have forgotten about social issues and fundamental rights. And he got re-elected, but he promised Europeans a social Barroso and a social Europe. So I'm still waiting for that. And I think that we should remind the European Union that the Lisbon Treaty and the European Union Charter for Fundamental Rights have entered into force on the 1st December 2009. And they are promising European precisely what the Icelanders are asking, which is democracy, fundamental rights, the role of law, social justice, and direct participation in the construction of the economic governance of Europe, mm-hmm. but also of the world. And what I am very worried on is that there was a window of opportunity, like you mentioned, that opens in 2008. Uh-huh. To build a better world, another world is possible. This is what the activists say, if we just stand and fight for it. And what I'm very worried is that this window of opportunity that opened is closing down. And now, like in any revolution, there is a counter-revolution fighting back for power. Mm-hmm. And I just would like to mention, for instance, the film of Luchino Visconti, Il Gatto Pardo. It's a wonderful film where you see the old world of the aristocrats collapsing and the middle class, the bourgeoisie, coming forward, gaining power. Mm. And Alain Delon saying to his uncle, which is the Principe di Salina, uncle, I have to go and fight with the revolutionaries, with Garibaldi, and the old aristocrat, which is Bart Lancaster, yes. who says, yes, good luck, but you will have to understand something, that something has to change so that all remains the same. Like, we will all, like, so that the power is not the structures of powers, the structures of economic governance in the world and in the European Union, they are not changing.
Yes.
And it is business as usual. And my conclusion is that Iceland now has a wonderful opportunity. And I'm not saying whether the presidential decision was good or bad. I mean, it is a fact. We have now something that the others are also saying. We have a wonderful opportunity now to just stand up, fight for our arguments, fight for bring our perspective into the world with all dignity mm-hmm. and respect, and that we should remember what the real debate is about, which is the fundamental rights in the construction of the internal market. And I just would like to send a message to the European Union, a very strong message, that this time the protests have been peaceful, 60,000% collected in the internet, and in an island that is 4,000 kilometers away from Brussels. But next time it will be maybe millions of people marching in Madrid, in Paris, in Frankfurt, in London, because they have lost their jobs and because the European Union has failed them. So they should listen very carefully to us, and I hope that they do.
Maria Elvira Mendez Pinedo, that's your full name.
Yeah.
You have been living in Iceland for quite a long time, and you know mm-hmm. Iceland very well. I will put this, publish this on my blog, your article.
Thank you
so
very much.
So people can look at it in full. Thank you for being here. I have another guest on the telephone, Gerard van Vliet. From Holland? Yep. Hello, are you there?
I'm fine.
Yes, you were on this program earlier this winter. You are the advocate of the Dutch people who put their money into iSafe.
Yes.
Yes. I would just like to ask you shortly, what are the reactions in Holland about the presidential veto?
They're mixed. On the one side, of course, there's politicians that would like to see the money back as soon as possible, especially the Minister of Finance, who signed a memorandum of understanding together with his former colleague in October 2008, a long time ago already. On the other side, there are more and more people that are balancing the positions. On one side, we know that there's a responsibility with supervisors in Iceland. On the other side, we are also aware of the fact that they couldn't go as far as they went as long as the Dutch and the UK close their eyes.
But do you think there's a problem? There's a possibility of renegotiating the whole thing for the third time?
Well, there have been possibilities from the beginning. It's a question of who is on which side of the table, and what is the aim of the negotiations. If you, as Icelanders, don't put on the table more than, yes, we want to have a loan arranged for, like was said in the Memorandum of Understanding, then the reaction on the other side of the table is not more or less than that. If you put on the table, we would like to have your help, we would like to have a general integrated solution, and part of that should be a financial solution, then it's another deal. You've got another aim in order to negotiate. That's a question of your own fault from the beginning.
But from what I understand, you actually wrote a letter to the Icelandic president before his decision.
Yes.
What did you say in this letter?
We said that, according to us, everybody will...